I'd like to welcome you this morning in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ as we gather to worship our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'm just going to start with a few notices, and then after that we're going to just read a few verses from a psalm and pray as we continue our worship together. I say a few notices, there are a few here, so let's begin them. The first one is we have an AGM meeting on Wednesday, and that is a members meeting, so members only. And I've been asked to mention that there are a few people away this week, so if you are a member and you are available, please come to the meeting, because we need as many as possible so that we can be quorate, so that we can vote on some things. So please do come if you are able. Also, on Wednesday, we have the first cream tea of the year, and that's at 2 to 3.30. Please come to that if you can, and if you are coming, please invite someone. It is a great opportunity to invite a friend along to hear the gospel. Maybe you've got a neighbour, and you're never able to get to the gospel with them. Somehow, the conversation always changes. Well, if you bring them to the cream tea, Andy will faithfully preach the gospel. So please bring them along 2 to 3.30 on Wednesday. Finally, don't get your hopes up. I don't know why I said finally. Thirdly, this is a notice from myself. The Open Air Mission do team events. We were just in Northern Ireland this past week doing a team event where a team of us go to a certain place and we do a mission for a week or so. Well, we've got one in Derbyshire this next week, and that's at Tissington. Every year, Tissington do well dressings just near Ashbourne, and we're doing a week's mission there. We're not doing open-air preaching, but what we're doing is we go into the church on the top of the hill. If you know Tissington, we put on a video that shows how the well dressings are made, and through the video, the gospel is shared, and then at the end, we also have a brief epilogue where we share the gospel. And the reason why it's such a good opportunity is because a lot of the well dressings in Tissington have biblical themes. And so they're beautiful to look at, but many of them have got Bible verses on and things like that. So please do come along to that. That's why I'm mentioning it. So you can pray for it, but also come along. You can invite your parents, your neighbours, your friends. Bring them along, and they will hear the gospel if you get them into the church on the top of the hill. So please do come along. But it is a great day out as well. But please also pray for that. Last year, we had over 1,000 people who came into the church and heard the gospel through the week. So please do remember us in prayer, but do come along as well. It's a great opportunity to invite friends. I've also been asked to remind you about the fellowship meal, which is on the 19th of May. Please do sign up for that. It's wonderful that every time more people stay, and that's great. But I think it helps the catering team if they know how many are coming. So please do sign up for that. Around the side there's a sheet for you to put your name on. On the 13th of May, Monday the 13th of May, at Stanage Chapel, which isn't very far from here, they've got a gentleman coming from London City Mission, who is called Scott, and he's coming to speak about the work. So if you don't know much about the London City Mission, or you do know and you want to continue to support that work, please go to Stanage on Monday the 13th of May. I do believe Liz is going to put that on the notice sheet as well, but it's just a reminder. Please go and support that. The time is 7:45 on Monday the 13th of May. Just a couple more notices. Margaret has asked me to mention this, and I think this is very important. That Barnabas Aid is currently doing a petition. They want people to sign a petition so that they can bring it to the United Nations. And I'll just read it for you. It's about Christian persecution in Africa. This is what it says. Barnabas Aid is organizing a petition to end the genocide of African Christians. That word genocide isn't too strong either. It says around 45,000 believers have been killed by violent extremists in Nigeria since 2009. That's larger than many towns in this country, population of many towns. 45,000 believers have been killed by violent extremists in Nigeria. Around 5,500 in the Democratic Republic of Congo since October 2014. Around 1,800 in northern Mozambique since October 2017. That makes around 52,300. They want around 52,300 signatures on the petition so they can take this to the United Nations. They want you to pray that they'll get that, and of course pray for these persecuted Christians. But then also, they want you to sign the petition. So you can do that today. You can go to Margaret, who is sitting here, and she's got a piece of paper for you to sign, or you can go on their website, barnabasaid.org/resources/African petition. If you just type in Barnabas African petition on Google, you'll find it. Please do sign that. That is very important. In a minute, we're going to pray for them. But before we do, we're just going to, Philip Spackman is going to come and just bring us a notice.
Lots of notices, because there's lots of things going on, which is really good. So good morning from the Health and Safety Executive at Walton Evangelical Church, otherwise known as me. My apologies, because this relates to health and safety, but please don't switch off as it relates to a goodly proportion of the congregation. My job is to ensure your safety, and to that end, I need your help. Last year, I offered you a little booklet which was called Safety in Your Hands. That's still a relevant booklet, but I need to update my records for annual review. In the entrance lobby, you will find a little booklet here. Please don't take it away. and a sign-up sheet here. Please don't take it away. And on the sign-up sheet, you'll see loads of names have been added. Your names, in fact. There are some names on here, I don't even know who they are, actually. And some people on here don't even come to our Sunday services either. But they're all relevant, because if you use anything electrical in this building, that's a vacuum cleaner, a kettle, a coffee grinder, a coffee machine, an espresso machine, anything to do with almost coffee, basically, because it's hot water, and portable heaters, computers, and the like, then you need to look at my little document and sign the appropriate sheet, please, and this will help me a lot. And if you have no idea what I'm talking about, come and talk to me, please, over a cup of water or something similar. Thank you.
Thank you, Philip. Well, as we've just been thinking about health and safety, let's pray for the safety of the Christians in Africa as we just begin our time in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you for our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that because of him and his finished work upon the cross and his resurrection on the third day, we thank you that we can come boldly before the throne of grace. Father, we thank you that because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, we know that you now make all things work together for good to those who are called according to your purpose, Father. And we do pray for ourselves this morning. We pray, loving Father, that you will be with us in our time of worship. Father, that you will enable us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we do pray also for our brothers and sisters in Christ, particularly in Africa today, who can't worship you with such freedom. Father, we pray for them. We pray that this petition will exceed all expectation, that they will get so many more signatures. And Father, we pray that the UN will take notice. And Father, that this genocide of Christians in Africa will stop. Father, we pray for the persecutors. And we pray that you will show them that they are doing evil and not serving the true and living God. And may, Father, there be a work of mercy and grace done among them. Father, we pray for your dear people, and we pray that you will strengthen them and sustain them and help them to remain faithful, even in the face of fierce persecution. Father, we thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Well, we're just going to read a couple of verses from a psalm before we continue our worship in song. This is what it says. It says, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is the great God and the great King above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand." Well, we're going to do that now with our next hymn. If you're able, please do stand and sing.
Hear the call of the King. Let's come together now and pray to our great God. Father, we've just confessed how great you are, and you are the sovereign Lord. You are the one who rules over the nations. And so what a privilege it is to carry everything to the Lord in prayer. We thank you that we can come before you as children to a loving heavenly Father. But you are the God who does as you please with the powers of heaven and the peoples of the earth. And so we pray, Lord, that you would have mercy upon our world, that you would have mercy upon our generation, upon those who have turned their backs on you. Lord, that there would be revival, a turning of people to you. We thank you that you are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, that you maintain love to thousands and forgive wickedness, rebellion, and sin. But you do not leave the guilty unpunished, for you are a God of supreme justice. And Lord, we do pray for our own country. We pray for those, Lord, who lead us, many of whom are in new positions after the elections this week. Father, we pray that your hand would be on our country, that you would grant wisdom to those who lead and who make decisions and who care for people. Father, we pray that you would grant salvation, that you would turn their hearts to you, that they would live in the fear of the Lord, that they would do justly and love mercy and walk humbly with you. Father, how we plead this for our nation. Lord, in the larger world too, we pray for conflicts going on around our world. Lord, still on our hearts is the situation in Israel and Gaza, where there is so much heartbreak, so much anger, so much cruelty, so many suffering, loss, and grieving. Father, we pray for peace. We pray for the Ukraine, where war still rages. We pray for the Sudan, where thousands and thousands of people have been displaced. Father, we just pray for peace. We pray, Lord, for your people in these lands. We pray, Lord, for the witness of your church, that they might be able to reach out to their neighbors with love and compassion and show the gospel by the way that they live and in the words that they speak. Father, we pray for your persecuted church. We just prayed for those in Nigeria. We pray for those also in the Democratic Republic of Congo as well. Lord, that even if the UN doesn't take notice, you are the God who sees. So, Lord, we pray that you would care for your people, protect them, help them to be a witness for you. Father, we pray that in our world your gospel would prosper. We pray, Lord, even here locally, that you would help us as we seek to take this good news into our own community. We do pray, Lord, we commit to you the cream tea this week, an opportunity for locals to come in and hear that good news. Lord, we pray for the schools work we were thinking about earlier on this week at the prayer meeting, for these wonderful opportunities and new opportunities to go into schools and share some of your word, some of that good news with children as they grow up. We pray, Lord, that you would turn their hearts to you even while they are young. We pray, Lord, for the witness of individuals in this church as we witness to those in our homes, in our workplaces, in our schools. Father, help us as your people to be light in this world, to be a city on the hill, noticed by all, noticed for the right reasons, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us to be salt, that we would make a difference in the world around us. And Father, we pray also for those amongst us who are struggling, suffering, distressed in these days. We want to commit to you, Lord, Brenda. We pray, Lord, that you would give skill to the doctors who are diagnosing and caring for her. We pray, Lord, that you continue to give her a peace that passes understanding, We pray, Lord, for your gracious healing hand to be upon her. We pray for Rudy as he recovers from sickness and as he cares for her too. Father, we pray for John Chillingworth. We pray for his continued recovery from his stroke. We pray, Lord, for healing so that he might be able to be discharged. We pray for June and the family too as they visit and as they care for him. We pray, Lord, that that family would know the comfort of your presence throughout this period. Father, we also pray for the Hall family as they grieve the loss of Betty. We pray, Lord, for their continued witness to the extended family. And Lord, we pray that that funeral next week would be, though a time of grieving, also a time of joy and celebration as we remember the life of Betty, who's now in the presence of her Saviour. Lord, we bring all of these things to you. We trust you as the all-wise, all-powerful God, that you will do even beyond what we ask. For we ask it in the name of your dear Son. Amen.
The reading this morning is Genesis chapter 17. If you're using the Church Bible, it's page 16. Genesis 17. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will confirm my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers." Abraham fell face down. And God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abraham. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. The whole land of Canaan, where you are now an alien, I will give as an everlasting possession to you and your descendants after you, and I will be their God." Then God said to Abraham, "As for you, you must keep my covenant, you and your descendants after you, for the generations to come. This is my covenant with you and your descendants after you, the covenant you are to keep. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You are to undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and you. For the generations to come, every male among you who is 8 days old must be circumcised, including those born in your household or bought with money from a foreigner, those who are not your offspring. Whether born in your household or bought with your money, they must be circumcised. My covenant in your flesh is to be an everlasting covenant. Any uncircumcised male who has not been circumcised in the flesh will be cut off from his people. He has broken my covenant." God also said to Abram, "As for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her." Abraham fell face down. He laughed and said to himself, "Will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? And Abraham said to God, "If only Ishmael might live under your blessing." Then God said, "Yes, but your wife, Sarah, will bear you a son, and you will call him Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him. And as for Ishmael, I have heard you. I will surely bless him. I will make him fruitful and will greatly increase his numbers. He will be the father of 12 rulers, and I will make him into a great nation. But my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you by this time next year." When he had finished speaking with Abraham, gone went up from him. On that very day, Abraham took his son Ishmael and all those born in his household or bought with his money, every male in his household, and circumcised them as God told him. Abraham was 99 years old when he was circumcised, and his son Ishmael was 13. Abraham and his son Ishmael were both circumcised on that same day. And every male in Abraham's household, including those born in his household or bought from a foreigner, was circumcised with him.
Well, we're going to sing our children's song now. Romans 5 verse 8 says that God shows his love towards us and that while we're still sinners, Christ died for us. And our children's song is all about the love of God. After we have sung this song together, the children will go out to their Sunday classes and there will also be a creche as well.
Say hello to the person next to you. Go on. You know you want to. Well, the previous weeks, they've done nothing. It's like silence. No, yeah. Okay, that's great. Carry on those conversations afterwards. Isn't it lovely to have friends and loved ones around you? That's really, really great. Let's pray for our children as they go out. Let's pray for ourselves as we look at that passage together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we're gathered together this morning. We pray, Lord, that we would be here with expectant hearts, expecting you to speak to us, to show us more of yourself, what you are like. to reveal to us more of our own hearts, and Lord, to work change in each one of us. We pray for our children too, Lord, and for those who teach them. We ask for your blessing on their time together as well, that they would learn wonderful things about the God who sent his Son to save them. So, Lord, speak to us all, we pray. Amen. Right. Now, according to the Mirror, librarian Jean Preston lived a very ordinary life. They describe it this way. She travelled by bus and ate ready meals. I mean, how much more ordinary can you get? But little did she know that the two paintings hanging in her spare room in Oxford were the missing pieces of the San Marco altarpiece by Renaissance master Fra Angelico. There he is. But she found them, apparently, in a box of scraps in the US in the 1960s and thought they were quite nice. It was only after she died in 2006 that their value was discovered, sending shockwaves around the art world. I'm quoting from the Mirror. In April 2007, they sold for £1.7 million to an anonymous buyer. That's quite something, isn't it? But I can beat it. So there's a picture of the painting up on the slide there for Dan. But this next one is wonderful. Even more remarkably, and this guy remains unnamed, but there's several sources you can look to for this. An unnamed US scrap dealer. Okay, so he's dealing in his metals and stuff. He saw something good, and he paid $13,302 at a bric-a-brac sale. I don't know what they mean by that, but any car boot sale I've been to doesn't have things of that value, right? But he found this sort of in his scrap dealing. He was hoping to sell it again and make a few hundred dollars profit on what he bought it for. But no one was interested, and so this device here, this piece of this ornament, stayed in his kitchen for years. Then in 2012, he Googled the words egg and Vacheron Constantin, which were etched on the side of this object, and realized it was a gold, diamond, and sapphire Fabergé imperial Easter egg with a clock inside, created for the Russian royal family in the 17th century, now worth $33 million. That's quite something, isn't it? I mean, I don't know why I never find these things. It'd be wonderful, isn't it? But imagine what it would be like to live your life as a pauper, your whole life, an ordinary life, just ready meals, right? And then discover that all along, all through those years, on your wall, or on your mantelpiece, there'd been an artifact worth millions and you hadn't known it. You had it, you just didn't know it. If either of those individuals, you see, I think, and this is the point, isn't it? If either of them had actually believed that the thing they owned was of that kind of worth, it could have been absolutely life-changing for them. And the same is true, if not even truer, in the spiritual realm. I want us to see that this morning. That is to say, if we really grasped the worth, the utter majesty and sovereignty of God, the way we've been praying this morning to the Sovereign Lord, and if we lived then in accordance with that belief, it would utterly change the way that we live. I'm convinced of that. That's why we need then to be turning frequently to his word and to be reminded again and again just who it is that we've put our trust in. Just who it is we are praying to when we pray. Well, that is my prayer this morning. And it's clearly what Abraham needed as this chapter opens. And it's what God provides right there in the first few verses. So we're going to get right into this chapter. And to give us a roadmap then, we will consider a revelation, a renaming, a ritual, and a return. That's our map through the chapter, if you're taking notes. Sorry, I've got a frog in my throat this morning. I apologize for that. Let's look at verses 1 to 2 then, a revelation. It's a revelation of who God is. This is what Abraham needs. Verse 1, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will confirm my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Now, in a previous chapter, if you were with us last week, we had the setting here, and it's very, very important. It's the essential backdrop to understanding really what's going on in this chapter. In that previous chapter, we were told about the birth of Abram's first son, Ishmael. Do you remember? Let me remind you, Ishmael is the product of his wife Sarai's scheme. It's a scheme to try and make the promises of God, promises that they've held on to for many, many years, start coming to pass, to give God a helping hand. Specifically, it's to help God with this promise of an heir, that is, a son who would come from Abraham's own body. So this couple are already, at the beginning of that chapter, the previous chapter, they're already 85 and 75 respectively. And the likelihood then, humanly speaking, that either of them, but more especially Sarai, would be producing any children this late in the day, it's vanishing fast, if not already gone. So Sarai, as we read the story, she enlists, or rather, I would say, conscripts the help of her maidservant Hagar, through whom she intends, verse 2 of chapter 16, to build a family. It's very kind of do-it-yourself kind of language, isn't it? Maybe I can build a family through her, she says. A family for herself and Abram. And Abram agrees to the scheme, okay? The blame is on both of them. And it appeared to be working when Hagar falls pregnant, almost immediately, it seems. But the results do not prove something right. You ever notice that? That's a dangerous form of pragmatism. To think that the ends always justify the means can be a huge mistake. This cunning plan of theirs results in a whole lot of pain and strife. We saw it, didn't we? We saw how Abram's home became a war zone. Sarai felt jilted by the whole thing, unloved, undermined, even threatened by her preening maid, who's now elevated as the one that's going to bring Abram actually a child. Did now Abram favor her above? And so she abused her to the point that she ran away. She fled southward back down to Egypt. But it's there on that journey that the angel of the Lord found her, made wonderful promises to her, made promises about her son, and assured her that as she goes home, the God who sees, the God who has heard her misery, is watching over her. And so she returns. And so Ishmael is born. That's really recapping the previous chapter. But what we have there is, well, here is the result of Sarai and Abram's effort to give God a helping hand, to fulfill God's promises by the power of their flesh. That's really the kind of theological way of thinking about it. Rather than, as they should have, patiently waiting for the Lord to act, for God to fulfill those promises in his time, in his way, without all of the pain and devastation around it. Now, no doubt Abram, and we have no evidence to the contrary on this, at the beginning of chapter 17, no doubt he now thought that despite all of the domestic chaos, all of the upset that had resulted, now at least things were happening. I mean, first of all, his big concern, you know, that the risk of leaving everything that he owns to this bloke Eliezer of Damascus, who's not even really related to him, at least that's finally been put to bed. He finally had his promised heir. And I guess he thinks this is all now part of the plan. But then chapter 17 happens. We just read it together, didn't we? 13 years have passed, we're told. And Ishmael's grown up. He's his father's pride and joy. He's on the threshold of becoming a man now, this lad. And then, at the age of 99, Abram receives another visit from the Lord. Now, things to notice in this chapter. Did you notice that actually it's a chapter full of new names? New names are everywhere in this chapter. There's four in total. I wonder if you noticed them. We're going to consider each of them. Here, finally, and this is such a relief to me, We can stop calling this couple Abram and Sarai. It just does my head in. I want to say Abraham and Sarah all the time, don't you? We can call them by those more familiar names now, finally. But the first new name actually is in the first verse, and it's neither of those two. It's arguably actually the most important of the new names. Here is the first occurrence in the Bible of a new name for God. And it's a name by which he now reveals himself to Abram. It's the name by which Abram is going to come to really relate to God in the rest of the book of Genesis. It's the Hebrew El Shaddai. Do you know that name? El Shaddai. It means God Almighty. Look at it there in those first verses. I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. Have you ever thought about that word, Almighty? You ever thought about it? What does it mean? It's not that complicated, actually, is it? It means that God is all mighty. It's basically the same. It's an English way of saying omnipotent, omnipotent, almighty. All might and power belongs to him. That's the God of the Bible. He has all might, all power. He is, in short, the God who can do anything. Thankfully, then, he is also good if he's the God that can do anything. I mean, if we had a fraction of God's might, it would be like handing a submachine gun to a monkey, wouldn't it? I mean, you ever watched the film Bruce Almighty? It gives you sort of a good sort of example of what that might look like. But what he does, what the God of the Bible does, the God for whom nothing is impossible, is always best. Now, contrasting the God of Israel then with the lifeless idols worshipped by the nations around Abram, the psalmist captures the concept of almightiness in Psalm 115, verse 3. Have a look at this. He says, "Our God is in heaven. He does whatever pleases him." That's a great description of what it means to be almighty. He does whatever pleases him. This is the God who is creator, not created. The laws of creation then, the creation order, they in no way restrict what this God can do. He is, after all, we saw at the beginning of the book, the one who spoke and creation came to be. I wonder if that's the God you believe in. I mean, perhaps you just say, well, yes, of course. But is it? That's the question. Is it really? Because I'm sure Abraham did too. But in light of what's happened in chapter 16 and what God is about to reveal to him, he certainly seemed to need a reminder to let it get a little bit deeper into his heart. And perhaps you and I do too. I think that's what enables us, surely, to be able to wait. To be able to wait for his timing is actually really believing in who he is. Well, after this revelation, the revelation of who God is, comes next in verses 3 to 8, a renaming. A renaming of God's man. Verse 3, Abraham fell face down, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham. For I have made you father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you." Now, Abraham responds then by falling down on his face. And it strikes me that is a correct attitude. When you've just been reminded that it is the Almighty God who is speaking to you, get on your face. And here is the second new name. This time it's given to Abram, who henceforth will be called Abraham. Now you have to understand that the big issue throughout Abram's life thus far has been this issue of childlessness. That's been the problem, hasn't it? That's the big headache. And the name Abram that he's carried through life has meant exalted father. He's had to carry the irony of that through the years, right up until his 80s when he has no kids. So, you know, people will visit and say, "Hi there, how are you doing, exalted father? How's the family?" "Oh, wait, yeah, that's right. It's just still you and the missus, isn't it, exalted father?" Now at least he has one kid, Ishmael. Now it makes a bit of sense that he's actually a father. And then it's going to change. God's moved the goalpost, hasn't he? His new name, Abraham, will mean father of a multitude. I mean, that's a cruel name, isn't it? Talk about giving more ammunition to the mockers. "Hi, Abraham, how's that little multitude of yours doing then?" I think perhaps this is God's way of pointing out that, okay, Abraham, you might have been able to achieve fatherhood by means of your flesh, but to become father of a multitude, now that you're going to need to start trusting, aren't you? You need to trust me. You need to walk by faith now. And now God repeats once more his covenant with Abram. And look at how it gets fleshed out even more. It's a wonderful covenant. It starts really in verse 6 where God says, "I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you. Kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God, to be the God of your descendants after you. The whole land of Canaan, where you're now an alien, I will give as an everlasting possession to you and your descendants after you. And I will be their God." Do you see what's said here then under this covenant? First of all, God will increase Abram's numbers. Well, we knew that. But he will not just be the father of a nation, but nations. And not just nations, but kings. Kings will come from him. Secondly, they will possess the whole of the land of Canaan. And thirdly, he will be their God. He's going to commit himself to being the God of this people. That sounds like the kind of promise that only the Almighty God can keep, doesn't it? And along with the renaming then, third of all to see in this chapter comes in verses 9 to 14, a ritual for God's people. And this is really one of the striking things of the chapter. Take a look with me then. Then God said to Abram in verse 9, "As for you, you must keep my covenant, you and your descendants after you, for the generations to come. This is my covenant with you and your descendants after you. The covenant you are to keep, every male amongst you shall be circumcised. You are to undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and you." So this is a first. God is telling Abram something that he must do. This is your side of the deal. This is your side of the covenant, the side of the covenant that you and your descendants must keep if they are to remain part of God's chosen people. The sign of the covenant will be circumcision. Okay, now I'm not going to get into that too much. If you don't know what that means, ask your mum and dad at the dinner table and it'll be a lovely conversation. I know that this is a topic that makes the gentleman wince. But circumcision, actually, the first thing to note is it was actually a relatively common practice in the ancient Near East. This is not the beginning of it happening. Not everyone did it. Apparently, it wasn't part, for example, of Abram's culture back in Ur of the Chaldeans. But there's plenty of evidence that it was, and I quote from a scholar, used widely as a rite of puberty or marriage. Something that the Israelite reader would have been well aware of. So at least, I mean, one of the comforting things there is, at least they knew what they were doing, right? Okay, it was a known practice. This scholar continues and says, this is helpful, I think. It was performed by the new male in-laws. I mean, that's a special relationship right there, isn't it? Indicating that the groom was coming under the protection of their family in this new relationship. I mean, aren't you glad we've moved on just a little bit? I think that's quite something. Here, God then takes this well-known practice and, as often happens, gives it a new theological meaning for Abram's community, for his household. It means that all of them are part of the community of God's chosen people, participators in the covenant that God has made with them. Now, just as a footnote here, I was asked by someone this week, why only men? Well, that's a good question, isn't it? Why is this seems to be some sort of special privilege for men? Well, my first point is, first, A, be thankful. That's my initial reaction. I mean, it's a strange thing to envy, isn't it? It's not a pleasant idea. But to be serious, B, actually to think that way misses the real point of circumcision, and we're going to look at that in just a moment. C, remember, God, who did God promise that the Messiah, the serpent crusher, would actually come from? That he would be the seed of the woman. It's interesting, isn't it? And actually, in both cases, it seems, both the man and the woman, both male and female, as one together, are necessary for executing God's plans and keeping God's covenants together. Let's not separate, look at each other separately. Let's look at each other together in this. It is a wonderful, beautiful thing. Now, the important thing here is that we are not to think that this sign by itself was actually what included an individual in the blessings of the covenant. Okay, now stay with me on this. The Jewish believers in the early church, as we've gone through the book of Acts, haven't we? They had to be corrected on this point. Circumcision was not a condition for salvation. It was not a condition for the inclusion of Gentiles into God's saving purposes. That's made crystal clear in the New Testament. And that actually, right going all the way back, consistency of God, that's a truth borne out by, let's say, for example, Ishmael, who went his own way after being what part of this circumcised community. He wasn't part of this blessing. It's also true of Abraham himself. This is the point the New Testament makes. Who's credited as righteous when? Before he was, we've already had it, haven't we? Before circumcision was even brought in for God's people. And so Paul then makes it really plain to the church in Galatia, who'd been led astray by Judaizers who wanted to push this idea. He says this to them, and it's pretty blunt. In Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. And again, later he says, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. What counts is a new creation. Do you see what's important? Do you see what Paul is saying? Counts, actually matters. Faith, new creation, those things that God does and works within. And so actually, likewise, even Moses himself points out that this outward symbol was supposed only ever to be an outward expression of something that he was hoping and praying would happen inside the people. Something that without which they were as lost as the nations around them. And that is how they often lived, didn't they? In Deuteronomy 30, after, and this is poor old Moses watching 40 years in the wilderness of pretty shaky faithfulness on the part of God's people. He utters this prophecy. This is prophetic. Deuteronomy 30, verse 6. The Lord your God will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your descendants so that you may love him with all your heart and all your soul and live. So circumcision always was to be an outward sign of an inner commitment required, by the way, of both men and women. And so it functioned then, and I've got to be, this is careful ground to tread on, it functioned then much like baptism does for us today. Okay, so think this through with me. Baptism itself, being dipped in the water, is what the word means, doesn't save you, but it is an essential outward sign of the inward commitment that you and I have made, men, women, and children. And so it's through baptism that we today identify ourselves as part of the family of God. Those who've been raised from death to life in Christ as part of the church. So then both circumcision in the Old Testament and baptism and actually communion as well in the New Testament contain this spiritual reality behind the sign. They stand for something much deeper than the sign itself. They stand for the person's relationship with God. Therein is the only source of blessing and salvation, not in the outward sign. Now, no doubt, additionally, as one author suggests, as we look back now at Genesis 17, circumcision would also serve Abraham as a constant reminder, your flesh will not bring about the fulfillment of God's promise. And so in the last part of the chapter, we now see a return to God's plan, a return to God's plan. Have a look at verse 15 with me. God also said to Abram, as for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings and peoples will come from her. Abram fell face down. He laughed and said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? Now, I can't remember where. I know I read it at some point this week. Someone writing about this visit between God and Abraham and saying that, you know, rather than it being a joyful and exciting visit, you know, and God has appeared to me. Now, actually, it might well have been a very uncomfortable and unpleasant experience for Abram. And that is because of what follows. You see, he had been carrying on for 13 years on the assumption that the plan that he and his wife had cooked up, whilst not perfect, had worked. It had got things going. But now, suddenly, with this visitation, his folly, his lack of patient faith are exposed, and there's a cost to pay. Here we see Sarai, first of all, getting a new name, which is a really positive thing. It's the third of the new names in the chapter, if you're keeping count. Let's look at it just briefly. There's debate about the significance of this change, and it is slightly a head-scratcher. It seems that simply she's moving from Sarai, which means my princess, yeah, it's got a possessive there, to Sarah, princess. Okay, my princess to princess. Okay. But it seems that like, and I think you've got to parallel it with Abraham's new name, the significance there is in the scale. She's not just a princess, a domestic my princess. She's a global, gone global princess, a great princess. Because she too, if you read this covenant, will not just be the mother of a nation, but nations, and from her also kings, and kings of peoples will come. It's glorious. But it elicits two noticeable responses from Abraham. Look at the first. The first is he falls down and laughs. That's quite a response. It's the utter madness of it all, actually, that he's laughing at, isn't it? Will God now do this wonderful thing? I mean, why now? Will a child be born to a couple pushing 100? I mean, it's almost indecent. Why not just go with what we've got, God? It's kind of his attitude, isn't it? Now, it will be important to realize, especially when we get to the next chapter, this is not the laughing of unbelief. It's not the laughing of unbelief. It's not a lack of faith on Abraham's part. Why do I say that? Because Romans 4 is very clear on it, actually. Romans 4, let's pop it up on the screen, says this, without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, this is talking about Abraham, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. I mean, that's really the big point of this morning's sermon in a nutshell, isn't it? Being fully persuaded God had power to do what he promised. That's what the walk of faith is about. And that's the key. Abraham is now fully persuaded of this, that God will do whatever he's promised, the right way, the right time. So this is the laughter of faith pushed almost to the limit of incredulity. But Abraham knows God can do it. However, amidst the joy, secondly, there is pain. The consequences of the past. What of Ishmael then? Verse 18, and Abram said to God, if only Ishmael might live under your blessing. Then God said, yes, but your wife Sarah will bear you a son, and you will call him Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him. So indeed, God does go on to reassure Abram that he has got big plans for Ishmael. They're there in verse 20, actually. But without getting distracted, it is with Isaac. This is the point. It's with Isaac, the line coming from that son, the child of both Abraham and Sarah, that the great covenant will be established. Now, Isaac is our fourth name, and it simply means laughter. It's a reminder of just how incredibly God kept his promise. Every time they would call their boy, they would know he was a laughable possibility, humanly speaking. It would just make you laugh to think this boy could even exist. Something that for man is impossible, but when it comes to the Almighty God, to El Shaddai, all things are possible. And verses 22 to 27 then tell us about how Abram carefully obeys God's instructions. He circumcises every male in his household, and they're brought into that community of the great promise of the mighty, almighty God. So what do we have here then to instruct God's people in their walk of faith? Well, I think we've already drummed it home enough, but we're going to just do it one more time. Abraham had to learn that rather than putting his efforts into cooking up a way to make God's promises happen, rather than relying on his own strength and cunning, he simply had to remember what it was he already had. Like a masterpiece hanging on the wall or sitting on his mantelpiece. He had a beautiful promise. He could appreciate it every day. But it was more than that. It was a promise from El Shaddai, from the Almighty God, not from a God like the God of the pagan nations, an idol that's powerless, not a fake, but the real thing, a promise from the Creator, the one who brings things into being. You see, all efforts made in our own flesh will achieve nothing. It is to the Almighty God that we must turn. Because it's only when you truly realize and grasp and hold on to who God really is that you and I have the confidence to trust him rather than turning to ourselves all the time. You ever find you do that? An incident, let's just finish with this, an incident in the gospel captures this kind of perfectly, this whole principle. You probably know the story. A rich and an important young man comes to Jesus to ask him, you know, Rabbi, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? That great thing. This man's operating on the assumption then that the answer to receiving the blessings of God is to do something in the power of his own strength. And so Jesus gives him actually what is an impossible task. I mean, it doesn't sound it. He tells him to give up his wealth. But actually, he's telling him to give up that which is most important to him. To give up the one thing that ruled his heart. In this case, his wealth. And then, having given that up, to follow him. To make Jesus number one. To follow this rough-sleeping itinerant preacher and his ragtag crew of misfit disciples. And the man was crestfallen. That's not something he could do. He had great wealth and he did not want to give it up. He couldn't change his heart. That's what owned his heart. Luke tells us Jesus looked at him and said, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. Indeed, it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. You see, it is hard, says Jesus, for those whose hearts are ruled by other things to surrender what they treasure most and give God the first place. Give him the first place. In fact, humanly speaking, well, okay, it isn't technically impossible. I mean, technically, you can get a camel through the eye of a needle, okay? But you can't do it without killing the camel and using some kind of a blender or something like that, I guess. I mean, I'm kidding here, because the point Jesus is making, it is impossible. You're not supposed to sit down and say, well, I can cook up some ways to do this. I can use my cunning and my cleverness and my skills to get a camel through the eye of a needle. No, it's impossible. And the disciples get it. They know what Jesus is saying. That's why they reply immediately to Jesus and say, well, then who then can be saved? Who can really change their own heart? Jesus replied, what is impossible with men is possible with God. And that's the point. So let us then remember, let us be reminded this morning who God is. The Almighty, the God of the impossible. And then let us live our lives in the light of that truth, brothers and sisters. Trusting Him to do even that which to us seems utterly impossible, should it be the best. And let's also pray in that belief too, that He is the God who can remove a heart of stone and replace it with a heart of flesh. He is the God who, according to Romans chapter 4, Abraham believed, gives life to the dead, calls things that are not as though they were. So let's come to Him now as we close in prayer. Father, remind us daily of our need to look to You and to put our trust in Your strength rather than our own. Help us as we read of You in Your word to grasp Your majesty, Your power, and Your authority. And may that be a safeguard against our own wandering, doubting, anxious hearts. For we ask it in the name of the King of Kings, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, we're going to finish with our final hymn, What is Our Hope in Life and Death? to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen.